And the issue of food security has long been a problem in the continent of Africa. And the late Premier has the following to say to the International Forum and especially to leaders in Africa. He said, or he's remembered to say, that if Africa needs to ensure its food security, we should focus on farmers as a basic resource. Let's have a look.
Lastly, why am I insisting on making sure that the communities and the warriors drive the process? It starts from the assumption that was made explicit by Ishak this morning. The main money, the main resource for breaking out of food insecurity is not mine, is not the European Union, is not USAID. It's the labor of the farmer. It's the land of the farmer. Implementation has to be designed around these main resources. It should be designed to make it easy for those who have the main resource to use the resource. Now, if we have conditionalities that our top-notch bureaucrats find it difficult to decipher, forget the present, then there cannot be implementation. And we will be freezing the main resource in order for us to design a system that we are comfortable with. That, to me, is illogical. If one must lose some resource, one is better off by losing the supplementary resource than by emasculating the main resource. Any implementation mechanism that hobbles initiative at the grassroots level is therefore simply unacceptable, because it hobbles the main resource that is available for us to break out of food insecurity.
And yet on another international forum, the late Premier was advocating about the issue of ideology that the continent has to follow. And he strongly advocated that Africa should break away from the Western neoliberal ideology and rather adopt developmental states so as to ensure rapid continental economic transformation.
Development is about social and economic transformation. For such transformation to succeed and for growth to be accelerated and shared, society at large must be an active and informed participant. The population at large must develop the norms, the values, and skills that would motivate them to add value and benefit in accordance with their contribution. In other words, there should be broad national consensus on the imperatives and strategies of development. The third and final character appears to be that the state should be politically and economically independent from the business community. This is so because the developmental state will have to use a heavy dose of both carrots and sticks to support the private sector and to direct it away from rent-seeking activities and towards productive ones. If the state is dependent politically and economically, it will be unable to apply either the sticks or the carrots, and hence to intervene effectively in the economy with the view to generating shared and accelerated growth. The developmental states in East Asia were able to keep their independence from the private sector while at the same time as supporting the private sector and capitalist development as a whole, because they could politically depend on the indifference, if not active support, of the large peasantry, and because they controlled the so-called commanding heights of the economy. The transformation of the predatory Kuomintang state in mainland China into the developmental state in Taiwan, the transformation of the predatory state of South Korea of the 1950s into the developmental state of the 1960s is a fascinating story that we cannot deal with here in the available time. The fact remains that developmental states are created out of predatory states through well-articulated programs of reform and transformation. The unique political economy that enabled such states to emerge is that of a large peasantry that benefited from radical land reform, both in Taiwan and Korea, and from effective rural development programs, and hence a large peasantry that was supportive of the developmental state at best and indifferent at worst. Such an environment neutralized the potential challenge to the states from key urban constituencies, particularly business and labor, and enabled them to maintain their political independence. The East Asian states were able to build on these, a huge state machinery, particularly that of the army. Both Taiwan and Korea, for example, had huge armies made largely of sons of the peasantry, which served to insulate the state from pressures of urban constituencies.